My name is Pastor Hannah, and I am glad that you are joining us for this time of worship online. I just want to let you know about a couple of things that we have going on in the life of our church, which actually we have a lot of things going on, but I want to encourage you to look at our website and check out the many wonderful opportunities we have for you to serve. And also, if you are one who has received a newsletter, read your newsletter. There's a lot of really good stuff in there. But I want to invite you, whether you are part of this church or you are listening in, to join us for a time of prayer this evening at 7:40 p.m. It is called Sunset Prayer, and that is when the sun sets. So join us for that time of prayer. I also want to invite those who are members or participants in the life of our church. We are having Charge Conference. It is coming up on September 15th. And we are not sure yet if that is going to be run via Zoom or if that will be run in person, but those details will be out as soon as we know them also. We already have one day of our Sales for Mission under our belt, and if you have missed that, do not worry. There is yet another day next Saturday that you can join us out on the lawn and look at some good stuff that you could take home with you. And one more thing. You are going to hear here in a short couple of moments a call to worship for this time and for your life. And I want to invite you, that call to worship was taken from the Now Action Anti-Racism Pledge. It is a prayer that is sent out every day to you, and it can be sent to you in your mailbox as well. All you have to do is go to wpaumc.org/now-action-pledge. It is a great way to keep you connected and in tuned to just being a part of the community who refuses to remain silent about the issues of race in our nation. So we hope that you will take advantage of these opportunities and join us as we serve God's kingdom.
We ask you to join in the call to worship, not just for this moment, but also as a call to worship for your life, because justice is a part of our worship. Behold the Lord, God's servant, the chosen one. God's Spirit rests upon the Son to bring justice to the nations. We need justice in our homes and communities today.
Come, Lord Jesus, with justice for the earth.
We need justice in our schools and on our streets today. We need justice in our nations and world today.
Come, Lord Jesus, with justice for the earth.
Lord, God's servant, the chosen one, we call upon you to uproot ungodliness in every crevice of human existence today.
Come, Lord Jesus, with justice for the earth.
We call upon you, Lord, the only righteous judge, to dispense the type of justice that transforms illicit behavior.
Come, Lord Jesus, with justice for the earth.
We call upon you, Lord, to provide the kind of justice that clears muddy waters of corruption.
Come, Lord Jesus, with justice for the earth.
The earth cries with the voices of the hungry, the maimed, and the slaughtered innocents.
Come, Lord Jesus, with justice for the earth.
This is for the busted hearts. This is for the question marks. This is for the outcast soul, lost control, no one knows. Sing it for the can't go back. Sing it for the broken past. Sing it for the just found out. Life is now upside down. If you're looking for hope tonight, raise your hand. And if you're feeling alone and don't understand, and if you're fighting in the fight of your life, then stand. And we're gonna make it through this hand in hand.
Together. This is for the second chance.
Pray together. God of justice and joy,
we gather together in your name
to proclaim the good news of your presence among us.
Where there is oppression,
we will shout a message of your liberating love.
Where there is sorrow,
we will sing a song of your healing love.
And where there is fear, doubt, confusion, or anger,
we will shine the light of Jesus Christ.
Your incarnate love,
in whose name we pray.
Amen. All right, I want to invite you to calm your kids down for a moment, if it's possible. Have them sit in front of the TV and grab their security blanket or grab that teddy bear or that thing that they turn to whenever they are afraid. For those who are watching and paying attention, this is actually a blanket that was made for me by my grandmother. And it was a blanket that was made when I was a baby, and it had become my security blanket. It is something that I think about, that I would grab whenever I was afraid or I just needed to be comforted. Now it is something that I use with my children. I used it with my daughter and will use it with my new child on the way. Right? It reminds me of my grandma and her strength, and it brings me comfort. Because you know, even as an adult, there are times that I am still afraid. What are the things that you're afraid of? What are you afraid of? COVID? You know, even as kids, I know you are not untouched by it. Are you afraid of going back to school or starting at a new school? Are you afraid of the homework or that your dog might eat it? Are you afraid of whatever else might be going on? I know that as kids, you have fears also. But what is it that you grab when you're afraid? Do you have a blanket like I have? Do you have a doll or a teddy bear or some type of stuffed animal? What is it that brings you comfort? Do you know that as followers of Jesus, it is our faith that acts as our security blanket? It is our trust in Jesus to always be with us that brings us comfort when we're afraid. So if you happen to be at school or you happen to find yourself without the ability to grab your security blanket, know that you can grab onto Jesus and he will help you get through your fears. Will you pray with me? Thank you, Jesus, so much for your constant love of us and your comfort you bring to us when we are afraid. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our scripture lesson for today is from Psalm chapter 7, verses 9 and 10. End the evil of those who are wicked and defend the righteous. For you look deep within the mind and heart, O righteous God. God is my shield, saving those whose hearts are true and right. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Stoplight, he can't be bothered by the hot cry written on the cardboard in her hand. But when she looks him in the eye, his heart is broken open wide, and he feels the hand of God reach out through him. As heaven touches earth, silence at the table, he wants to talk but he's not able, for all the shame that's locked him deep inside. But her words are the medicine when she says they can begin again, and forgiveness will set him free tonight. As heaven touches earth, God put a million, million doors in the world for his love to walk through. One of those doors is you.
Time in our service where I want to call you into a time where you get to exercise your spiritual disciplines. You'll hear me use that word almost every week because I believe it is so important that we continue to trust in God and to be called to obedience in giving to God back what he has given to us. This is our offering. out of a heart of gratitude, we give back to God. Nothing that we have actually belongs to us. It all belongs to God, and we are just stewards of it. So I would ask you to faithfully and to spiritually give to God what he has first given. And we are going to pray a blessing upon it. Will you pray with me? Almighty God, we do thank you for all you have given to us. We thank you, Lord, for the resources. We thank you for our finances. We thank you for our food, for the roof over our head, for the people in our lives. Lord, we thank you, and we give it all back to you. We surrender to you our relationships. We surrender to you our money, our pocketbooks, Lord. We surrender to you our schedules. We surrender to you our phone and our time and our energy, Lord. We surrender it to you for your use and for your glory. And Lord, I pray that you will call us to account with those things. You will convict us where we need to be convicted. That you will truly use us, Lord, and encourage us and challenge us to give more and more out of a heart that says thank you for what you have given to us. We know how generous you are, and it is an act of generosity and true obedience to you to give back. So, Lord, we give to you. We give to you with joy, Lord, and we pray that you take it and you use it for your glory. Lord, we also pray to you and lift up to you the names of those who are on our hearts, the names of those who we love deeply, the names of those who we are praying for in our own lives. As a community, we come together and lift them up before your throne of mercy and grace. We lift up our nation. We lift up, Lord, our leaders. We lift up those who are fighting for justice within our nation in the brokenness of our systems, Lord. Lord, we lift up to you our own voices as we join together in saying the prayer you taught your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. you bow your hearts with me in prayer? Almighty God, we ask that today you give us ears to hear and a heart to know the truths you have for us. Lord, and I do ask that you really help us to listen, even when it might get difficult or uncomfortable. And Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart are acceptable in your sight, and if they are not, that the Holy Spirit would steer me right. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So in 2008 or 2009, I'm apparently really bad at remembering dates unless I dig out my notes and figure it out, I got a privilege to go to Turkey. I went with Pittsburgh Theological Seminary on a cross-cultural immersion trip. We did a lot of touristy things, but largely the trip was about being immersed in the culture of Turkey and not the touristy things. So we stayed in a place called Maltepe, which was not a touristy area at all, and we got immersed in the Turkish culture, and it was an amazing experience. But while we were there in Turkey, we visited a ministry called Elam Ministries. Elam Ministries is a nonprofit charity whose focus is the love of Christ for Iran and beyond. During this particular week, they were hosting a group of people who were actually from Iran, who were Muslim and had converted to Christianity. Well, during our time there, I met a woman named Rosa, who Rosa has this amazing story of how she had come to faith in Jesus Christ. She lived in Iran, her and her mother and brother and father, and she was in a particularly difficult area where she really couldn't share her faith with others. And let alone being a woman in that area, she had absolutely no rights or privileges. But she could share it with her family. And her mom and her brother, they came to faith in Jesus Christ. Her dad did not. But he did allow them in the middle of the night to leave Iran, to go to Turkey, and to join in this program called Elam Ministries. Now, what this program did was it trained them up as leaders within their own community to go back home. It didn't keep them or send them out to other parts of the world, but to go back home and to share their faith in a safe way, but in a dangerous place. So I got some time to spend with Rosa, and one of the things I was particularly interested in was what was it that she faced in going back home? And the challenge for her really was her own fear. That was the thing that she was the most worried about, the fear that she had struggled with. It's no surprise to be afraid of going back into these dangerous places to do something that was not permitted, but she was afraid. She was afraid for her family. She was afraid for her father. She was afraid for her life. She was afraid of what would happen when she did go home. But it was interesting that she was also afraid of what would happen if she didn't go home. She was afraid of not sharing the love of Jesus with those whom she loved very much and she knew needed to know and hear about Jesus Christ. She was afraid. But then she shared with me this scripture. It's a scripture that will forever be on my heart. Her favorite scripture is from 1 John chapter 4, verse 18. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. For Rosa, she understood her fear to be a hindrance to her faith and intimacy with God. Not because fear in itself is bad, but because she was afraid that it would keep her from sharing this perfect love of Jesus Christ with others. She feared silence more than she feared any earthly punishment that could possibly happen to her. Before I left and we said our goodbyes, I asked her to write down the scripture for me in her own language, which was Farsi. And so she wrote down the words. She didn't write the whole scripture, but she wrote the words, "Perfect love cast out fear." And that is actually, if you notice, I have a couple of tattoos on me. And that is actually, if you see my arm, hopefully you can see that there. If you see my arm, that is her handwriting. The tattoo artist just traced over it. It is one of my favorite tattoos that I have on it, and I'm sure at another point in time I'll tell you about the other ones that are there also. But Rosa was an inspiration to me that day through the courage that she showed even in the face of her fear. I believe for you and I, there are a lot of things that keep us silent. We know that we should speak up for the injustices that we see taking place around us. We know that we should speak up against racism and prejudice against the voices that say a particular sexual orientation or gender identity is not welcome here. We know that we should speak up against gender inequality when we see wrongs being done to another, when we hear the type of talk that is full of hatred and harm. We know that we should speak up, but yet there are many things that keep us silent. I have fallen in that own category more times than I like to admit. We are good at making excuses and talking ourselves out of doing the right thing. We ask questions like, who am I? Like, really, who am I that people would listen to me anyways? What if I stutter? What if I say the wrong thing? What if someone calls me out on misinformation that I didn't realize was wrong? What if I am wrong? What if people don't like me after I have all of these things to say? What if I won't make a difference anyways? What if? I call this the what if game, right? We do this what if game and we remain silent. Ultimately, I believe this all comes down to fear. It is fear of the unknown. If we knew the outcome or that it would make a difference, a positive impact in somebody's life or in our community, we would not hesitate to do it. We would not remain silent. But this is why it is so important that we remember we are not alone and we are not weak. And we are not meant to be controlled by our fear. One of my favorite books in the Bible is the book of Esther. This is a story of not just one, but of two strong women who remain upright in heart, even in the face of their own fear and in the face of injustice. But they did it through encouragement that they found from others. The first woman, who we don't really talk a lot about whenever we talk about the book of Esther, is Vashti. And she's the one at the beginning of the story who is the queen at this time, who was called to parade her beauty in front of a drunken party of King Xerxes and his nobles. Now, it was very bold of her to refuse, but she did anyways. She knew that it would probably forfeit her life, which it did. It actually ended up leading to a decree where she was banished from King Xerxes' presence. We don't know what happened to her after that. But it's really interesting that in chapter 1, verse 20, they say this decree has to be written into place so that husbands everywhere, whatever their rank, will receive proper respect from their wives. So now we're at a point where the king is showing his hand and he needs another queen. But who would want to be the queen after a position like this, a claim, a decree like this has been made? However, the women within that area really didn't have much of a choice. So this is where Esther comes into the story. After so many people had gone before the king, so many women of a certain age and a certain status, Esther was finally the one who found favor and was chosen to be one of the king's many wives, to be the new queen. Now, in the backstory taking place, there is a man named Haman, who was one of the nobles on King Xerxes' court. And there is a man named Mordecai, who is a Jew, and just so happens to be Esther's cousin. You see, Esther doesn't really reveal that she is a Jew at this point in time. But Mordecai is her cousin, and Haman has a great hatred for him, and that dissension only grows deeper as they are in relationship with one another throughout the story. The hatred grows to the point where Haman gets the king to actually write another decree that states, on a certain day, at a certain time, all of the Jews in Susa will be annihilated. Genocide. They will be completely destroyed. And so here is where Queen Esther, where her choice in the story really begins to make a difference. Listen as I read to you from Esther chapter 4. We're going to start off with verses 1 through 6. When Mordecai learned about all that had been done, he tore his clothes and put on burlap and ashes and went out into the city, crying with a loud and bitter wail. He went as far as the gates of the palace, for no one was allowed to enter the palace gate while wearing clothes of mourning. And as news of the king's decree reached all the provinces, there was great mourning among the Jews. They fasted, wept, and wailed, and many people lay in burlap and ashes. This next part is really going to show us how far removed from reality Queen Esther was, as she was a part of the palace and all the palace life that went on. She had no idea what was going on outside of the walls. It says, when Queen Esther's maids and eunuchs came and told her about Mordecai, she was deeply distressed. She sent clothing to him to replace the burlap, but she refused it. Then Esther sent for Hathach, one of the king's eunuchs who had been appointed as her attendant. She ordered him to go to Mordecai and find out what was troubling him and why he was in mourning. So Hathach went out to Mordecai in the square in front of the palace gate. Now, being that Esther was removed from reality, what do we think was going through her mind at this point? Why was Mordecai in such despair? Maybe it was something to do with the family. Maybe somebody had passed away or was treated wrongly. Maybe Mordecai himself had done something bad. So starting at verse 7, Mordecai told him the whole story, including the exact amount of money that Haman had promised to pay into the royal treasury for the destruction of the Jews. Mordecai gave Hathach a copy of the decree issued in Susa that called for the death of all Jews. He asked Hathach to show it to Esther and explain the situation to her. He also asked Hathach to direct her to go to the king to beg for mercy and plead for her people. So Hathach returned to Esther with Mordecai's message. This news was probably a lot worse than what Esther was expecting to hear. And on top of this devastating news of the possible annihilation of her people, now Mordecai wants her to go and do something about it. Now Mordecai thinks that she can actually make a positive difference. We can tell that Esther was not so keen on that idea by the response that she gives to Mordecai. It says that, and starting at verse 10, if you're following along in your own scripture, starting at verse 10, then Esther told Hathach to go back and relay this message to Mordecai. All the king's officials and even the people in the province know that anyone who appears before the king in his inner court without being invited is doomed to die unless the king holds out his gold scepter. And the king has not called for me to come to him for 30 days. So Hathach gave Esther's message to Mordecai. What we see happening with Esther is that what if game, right? What if the scepter is not raised to me? What if I go before the king and I die? What if my plea doesn't make a difference anyways? What if? But Mordecai wasn't having any of it, right? Mordecai called her out on it. His response was fierce and it held back no punches. He says to her, Mordecai sent this reply to Esther. Don't think for a moment that because you are in the palace, you will escape when all other Jews are killed. If you keep quiet at a time like this, deliverance and relief for the Jews will arise from some other place, but you and your relatives will die. Who knows if perhaps you were made queen for just such a time as this? Message received. Esther sent this reply to Mordecai. Go and gather together all the Jews of Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. My maids and I will do the same. And then, though it is against the law, I will go in to see the king. If I must die, I must die. So Mordecai went away and did everything as Esther had ordered him. Now, the way the ending of the story goes is that Esther is accepted by the king. Esther does speak up and use her voice to save her people. Esther spoke up despite her fear. She refused to remain in silence, but that was not her first response. She needed the encouragement of her cousin Mordecai, who also refused silence, who had the more courage at that point in time, but was able to share it with her, was able to encourage her to use her voice for good, even if it was difficult to do. We need that encouragement from others sometimes, don't we? Maybe you aren't the one the message will be spoken through, but maybe your encouragement will lead someone else to speak. You know what is so fascinating about the book of Esther? The name of God is not actually mentioned one time in the entire book of Esther. Her identity as a Jew in this instance is more of an ethnic category than a religious one. This is a story that shows someone who is risking their life to prevent an act of genocide against her people. We don't need what that tells me is. We don't need the name of God thrown into every single story and every single conversation and every single act of love in order to know that something is good or something is right. We all have witnessed many times the name of God has been used to bring about harm and violence and genocide and justification for those things. I was just listening to the other day to a story about Elizabeth Smart, and we know that that happened years ago, but Elizabeth Smart was abducted at the age of 14 and held captive for 9 months. Her captor said that this was God's will for her life, and in the eyes of God, she was to be his wife. What evils have been done in the name of God? How many people have been kicked out of the church in the name of God? How many parents have disowned their gay children in the name of God? How many African Americans have been put into slavery or murdered in the name of God? This is what I believe the blasphemy of the Spirit is. What we have heard called the unforgivable sin in Matthew chapter 12, verse 31. But honestly, that's for a whole nother message on a whole nother day. But Rosa's story, the girl from Elon Ministries that I talked about earlier, is much like Esther's story. They were both afraid for their lives, but in the end, they were both more afraid of being silent. What is the what-if game that you play with yourself? What are the questions that you ask that put you into a place of silence? What fears do you have that stop you from speaking up and doing what you know to be right? Now, admittedly, we don't all have this great sense of justice and unjust or injustice. Just like the ones above who use the name of God for evil things, clearly, they don't have a great sense of what is right and what is wrong. So how do we grow that inner moral compass? How do we get to the place where we are willing to speak up and use the voice that God has given to us for good? You know, I could tell you to read the Bible more, go to church more, listen to more worship songs, get involved in more Bible studies, which, by the way, we have a couple of Bible studies coming up at the beginning of October that you can get involved in. A little shameless plug there, but that's not what I'm telling you to do in these moments. Those are all good things, but even those people who use the name of God in harmful ways, they might also know the Bible inside out. They might also go to church every single Sunday and serve on various committees. But what I want to tell you today, in order to truly understand when and how to speak up, in order to truly know what oppression, what it looks like, what injustice looks like, in order to truly have an understanding of that, what I want to encourage you to do is to spend time with the oppressed, right? Spend time with the poor. Spend time with our Black brothers and sisters. Spend time with people in the LGBTQ community. Spend time with those from a different country or a different race or a different tradition or a different religion than your own. Spend time. And maybe we can't do it physically right now. You're like, Pastor, you're telling me to spend time when I'm not even supposed to be next to my own family at this point in time. Then spend time listening. Spend time reading. Educate yourself. You can do it through movies. You can do it through books. You can do it through various podcasts that are out there. There are ways. But you have to first be willing to be uncomfortable. You have to first be willing to learn, to open up your ears and open up your heart, to be able to learn something new and to really seek to understand, right? To really listen to the stories of the oppressed, to really listen to the voices of others. And sometimes that does make us feel wrong. That does convict us and make us feel like the fool in these situations. And the truth is, we are afraid. We are afraid of being put into that category of the ones who have maybe done harm, whether knowingly or unknowingly. You know, this is, after all, what Jesus did, right? He spent time with the people who the systems of the powers in place did not favor. He heard from the voice of the oppressed, and he set out to right the wrongs by speaking some pretty unpopular truths that ended up leading him to his own death on the cross. Right? Because people have trouble hearing the hard truths, especially when it makes them feel bad. Don't be afraid of that. That is where your growth will come from, where you will learn how to use your voice for good. In Luke 19, 28 to 40, as Jesus was entering into Jerusalem on a donkey, his followers, which were many at the time, they began shouting, "Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest heavens." But some of the Pharisees who were present in the crowd told Jesus to rebuke his followers. Like, how could they say these things about him? And this was his response. "If they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." Are we not better than the stones? Are we not higher than the stones? Do we not have more spiritual depth than the stones and a greater connection to God than the stones? Or has your own fears worked you into a place lower than the stones, worked you into a place of silence? I want to encourage you today to change the face of your community. If it does not include the other, if it does not include the one different than you, we need to change the face of our churches if the faces within them all look the same. We need to be intentional about it, and we need to make sure that we are spending time with those, the systems of power that are in place in our country, do not favor. so that we can gain the courage and understanding of when and how to speak up. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, help us to be like Rosa, help us to be like Esther and Mordecai, help us to be like the people who just seem to have it within them to not be afraid to speak up. We know that that can be us too. May we speak up and encourage others to do the same. Lord, may we be and use the voice that you have given to us to glorify who you really are. Lord, it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
When the Lord comes passing through, he calls out to you, will you lay down your nets? When the Lord tells you what to do, sell a thing or two, give money to the poor. What are you waiting for? Even the stones would shout, they cry your name aloud. Every bush, every tree, and all the water in the sea. Even the rocks would sing the coming of the King. Every brick in the wall would answer the call, the Savior who claims all our fear and our doubt. Even the stones cry out, even the stones cry out. When the Lord came walking by and he caught your eye, did you leave your tree? When the Lord sat down to eat, did you bathe his feet and dry them with your hair? The pool will still be there. Even the stones would shout, they cry your name aloud. Every bush, every tree, and all the water in the sea. Even the rocks would sing the coming of the King. Every brick in the wall would answer the call of the Savior who claims all our fear and our doubt. Even the stones cry out, even the stones cry out. The first stone, we erected the cross. He paid for our sins and we mourn for the cost. Like the stone rolled away, he conquered the grave. All of heaven and earth shall resound with his name, with his name. When the King comes riding in, palms away, Gethsemane, will you fall asleep when darkness reigns? Betray him with a kiss. Even the stones would shout, they cry your name aloud. Every bush, every tree, all the water in the sea. Even the rocks would sing the coming of the King. Every brick in the wall would answer the call of the Savior who claims all our fear and our doubt. Even the stones would shout, the crying name aloud. Jesus, every bush, every tree, and all the water in the sea. Even the rocks would sing the coming of the King. Every brick in the wall would answer the call of the Savior who claims all our fear and our doubt. Even the stones cry out, even the stones cry out, even the stones cry out, even the stones cry out.
At the end of each of our bulletins, there is a little line that says, "We take the light of Jesus into the world." I want to encourage you to do that this week by speaking up and encouraging others to do the same. In the name of God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.